no phone. Don't need no speedy car to get me home. Don't need no nothing, all I need is time for the simple life. Ooh, go get your butt off of that lazy couch. Put down a laptop and get out of that house. Don't need no nothing, all I need is time for the simple life.
I'm your host today, Cynthia Fernandes, and I will be with you for this next hour of Simple Life with our guest in studio, Dr. Marc Gafni. Marc is a, he's a visionary, but let me tell you first about his involvement in the founding of Center for World Spirituality, which is a nonprofit organization. Was founded in 2010 along with Mariana Kaplan and a leadership team, and it's expanded to dozens of the most respected spiritual teachers, leaders, authors, and activists in the world today. It's currently based in San Francisco Bay Area, but I wanted to start off our show today by playing a part of a clip for you. And this clip, if you were to go to YouTube, you would find it titled Stop Doing Business as Usual. Here is Dr. Marc Gafni.
Welcome to the Center for World Spirituality. Spirit's next move. What does that mean? What are we here to talk about? We're here to talk about the moment where we stop doing business as usual. Where we start being concerned about ultimate issues. Where we become intoxicated. We become thrilled. We become awakened to our own ability at the leading edge to participate in the conversation, to participate in the next stage of spirit's unfolding, to shape the discourse, to create a space of insight in which we move beyond the concerns of everyday pettiness. We move beyond the concerns of he said, she said, this happened, that happened. We move beyond the self-contraction of fear and smallness, and we begin to access our larger selves, right? Our wider selves. We begin to access our more expanded consciousness, where we begin to think as divine beings. We begin to think as responsible human beings. We begin to think about the larger vista and vision of reality and our place in it, and how do we ensure that tomorrow is what it needs to be, that tomorrow is filled with goodness and it's filled with compassion and it's filled with love and it's filled with human dignity and it's filled with a world in which people understand that that which unites us is so much greater than that which divides us. The question that we're asking ourselves in this space, in the space Center for World Spirituality, isn't it time to stop business as usual? Right? Isn't it time to actually come together and forge a vision of a world spirituality in which commitment to goodness, commitment to love, commitment to spiritual practice, commitment to being there for each other, right? Commitment to showing up. With those commitments, right, become the core and fabric of our being. When those commitments to joy, right, to the fullness of life, to the ecstatic urgency with which we move towards the creation of a better world, animate us, delight us, invite us, right? That's what we're here to talk about.
And so we are. So welcome, Marc. Thank you so much for being here. It's an honor to have you.
Cynthia, what a delight to be with you. Awesome.
Well, you know, this really stood out to me, this stop doing business as usual, because there is so much going on in the world at the moment, and has been for a few years, actually, that people feel overwhelmed.
Yeah.
And yet we all tend to continue our daily, people call it daily grind, you know, go to work,
yeah,
pay the bills, fill the gas tank, yeah, take care of the kids.
all of that.
Yeah, but you're saying stop doing business as usual.
Well, we don't want to stop taking care of the kids, and filling the gas tank is always a good idea out there. Do not drive without gas, says the Dr. Gafni. However, right, there is a deep need that people have, Cynthia, right, to play a larger game.
Ah.
You know, like people go to Superman. When you go to Superman, you kind of ask yourself, damn, wasn't that supposed to be me? Did they miscast that? Like, why am I doing this little small thing in my life? Right? So there's this deep sense that people have that there's a larger game to be played.
Right.
That I have a role in that larger game and that my voice actually matters. And what happens is the grind, as you call it, the bind, right, of daily living and the sense of impotence, the sense that I'm not potent, that I'm not quite sure how to affect things. I'm not quite sure how to change things, right? The problems are bigger than me, and I've got to just deal with my own. So what happens is we close. We close because it all seems too big. It seems too vast. We're not sure what the point of entry is. And to the precise extent that there's a gap between our ability to affect things and our experience of the great pain of things, right? The gap between those two, right, actually causes people to close. So I look at the world and I say, wow, that's like there's a lot of bad stuff going on out there. And then I say, well, how can I affect it? And I can't quite find the way in to affect the largeness of it all. That's so painful, that sense of impotence, that we close. And we close when we find any manner of rationalization for closing. And so what we're really about at the Center for World Spirituality, and what we're really all about, right, is opening again, right? Opening our hearts again and actually realizing that the only response to outrageous pain is outrageous love. And to be an outrageous lover is to actually keep every boundary that should be kept and to break every boundary that should be broken.
I love that.
Right? And to commit outrageous acts of love and begin with your circle.
Right? Your own sphere of influence.
Begin with your sphere of influence and identify the unique need that exists in your sphere of influence that can be addressed uniquely by you, and then you'll begin to have impact. And so the entry point is always from within your own sphere, your own circle of intimacy, your own circle of influence. In that circle of influence, there is some place where you can show up as an outrageous lover. You can show up as a catalytic force. You can show up, right, in a transformational pivoting point, and you can make all the difference in a way that actually no one else can but you.
So that ties right into your current latest book.
It does.
Your Unique Self.
Unique Self, The Radical Path to Personal Enlightenment. Good book.
It's a great book.
Awesome.
And for all of you listening, we are in studio with Dr. Marc Gafni, and this is Simple Life. The book we just mentioned, Your Unique Self, is a stellar book. We will have it in the store. If you're in the store at Pilgrim's Way Community Bookstore right now, the delivery truck has not quite arrived.
But it's getting there soon.
But it's coming. And so, you know, this, by the way, Marc, concept or descriptor, your unique self, is very exciting to me. There's a lot of conversation within the, I'll call it loosely, the New Age community or New Spirituality community, of conforming and letting go of self, letting go of ego.
Right.
And this seems to be different than that.
That's right. In other words, Your Unique Self is a book that really emerged from pretty much 30 years of kind of intense, delightful, you know, impassioned engagement with the great Enlightenment traditions of the world. Right? I'm a kind of social activist Enlightenment teacher, whatever that means. And of course, we only teach what we need to know. But Enlightenment is perhaps the single most powerful idea available in world culture. And it actually exists in every culture in some form. And the idea, in a word, is that the status quo, the way you are right now, that's the way you're starting. That's the beginning of the story.
Right.
But you actually have an invitation to genuinely self-transform, to genuinely evolve, to genuinely step up and play a larger game, to genuinely engage in an evolution of your consciousness, a transformation of your identity, which is the source of both your power, your joy, your creativity. It's the change that changes everything. But the way that change, that transformation is classically understood is leave your story behind, right? Leave your personal sense of self behind and identify with something larger. Now, that's really correct. It's true, but it's partial. Uh-huh. It's only half the story.
It's only the first step. So if you stop there, you're going to stop at the first step.
If you stop there, then you're going to be engaged in arrested development. Uh-huh. Right? And arrested development in psychology and in any other part of the world always gets you in trouble.
Eventually.
Right? Usually sooner than later. Because what you're doing is, let's see if we can make a little map for people, which is really easy to follow.
Okay.
So there are essentially what we might call four or five selves. When we say self, which self do we mean? So simply, there's an ego self, level one. And your ego self is healthy and good and important, and it's the sense that Cynthia is Cynthia and Mark's Mark, and that's exactly as it should be. And if we don't have that sense, we're psychotic. So that's important.
Okay.
So I've got an ego sense, a separate self sense. That's great.
Yeah.
Healthy, separate self. The problem is, part two, level two, when I think that's the whole story.
Oh.
That all I am is a separate self. And I'm separate from Cynthia, and I'm separate from Source, and I'm separate from nature, and I'm separate from the larger contexts, and I'm a skin-encapsulated ego struggling to survive, competing, grasping, right, trying to prove that I exist, and screaming every day, I exist!
Me against the world.
Right, and we've got this implicit kind of notion, right, drummed into us by culture that ultimately, after all the nice New Age, you know, aphorisms are said and done, it's me against the world.
Yeah.
So then I move from there, and I go from separate self. And I realize if I practice, if I do a set of clear, powerful practices that have different forms in all the world traditions, but there are clear practices that I can do to actually expand my consciousness, to actually get a deeper view of what the true nature of things is, to actually see into the interior face of my reality. And I can actually know through practicing, I get genuine knowledge. It's not a dogma. It's not what somebody else told me. It's not someone else's credo. I can actually get direct first-person knowing that actually I am part of a larger context, that I'm actually not separate, that actually I am indivisible from the seamless code of the universe,
mm-hmm.
and that actually all of the power and all of the love and all of the creativity that initiated all that is actually flows through me. And if I let the wall or the illusion of separation down, I actually wake up. I was asleep, and I experienced myself as being indivisible from the larger context as the core of my reality. Now, that's a powerful transformation. And that transformation is beginning to become, glimmers of it are becoming apparent today through physics, you know, through world economies that are interlocked. But those are just hints. Those are hints of interlocking. But that interlocking system, that enmeshed system, isn't just economic. It's not just the enmeshment and attraction between particles. We actually are substantively not separate from anything else.
Mm-hmm.
Right? There's part of me and part of you that's actually the same, meaning we both participate in the same true self.
Mm-hmm.
So I've moved from separate self to true self, and the total number of true selves in the world is one.
Mm.
But it's the singular that has no plural. Now, here's the key. That doesn't mean that I'm not separate self. It doesn't mean you stop being Cynthia. I don't stop being Mark. We don't deride the ego. The ego self's important. I transcend the ego self, but I include it.
Okay.
Right, to this place of true self.
Right.
And true self is what is usually called enlightenment, which is, how would people usually define enlightenment? Oneness.
All with one, yeah.
All with one, yeah, one with all.
Yeah.
The only problem with that is, you know, it's a little boring, right? Right? In other words, and it's when you kind of think about it, you know, if you're really honest with yourself, like, really? Do I really want to be one with all that is? It's kind of that, you know, that Zen joke, you know, want a hot dog, make me one with everything. Like, really? Right? Like, and there's this sense like, oh my God, like, okay, so I'm one with everything. I'm enlightened. I've awakened to that true nature of reality, but it feels like something's off. What happened to me?
Yeah, you disappear.
Where'd I go?
Yeah.
And so the enlightenment teachers say, well, that's just your ego talking.
I see.
Got to get beyond that ego. You're just grasping to the story that you're clutching on, right, to that ego self. But actually, people intuit that there's something deeper.
Uh-huh.
And the Enlightenment teachers, all my good friends, who are wonderful and beautiful, actually didn't get this one exactly right. They got the first step right. Move from separate self to true self. Realize I am part of a larger context. I'm part of a larger story. I can play a larger game. That's exciting.
Mm-hmm.
But then I wake up and I realize that I'm also irreducibly unique. That actually, as I wake up from ego to essence, I realize I'm an irreducibly unique expression of essence, unlike any other that ever was, is, or will be. There's a snowflake essence, right, to my being, but unlike a snowflake, it never melts, right? It's irreducible. And when I actually go deeper into that, I realize, wow, right, I'm an irreducible expression of the very love, intelligence, and love beauty, right, that initiated the entire process, the entire great evolutionary process. I am a unique expression of the animating eros of all of reality. I'm a unique self.
Right.
That's exciting.
Well, it does, because then you count.
You absolutely count.
And you have your own contribution that's not only welcomed, it's necessary. And we're going to talk more about that.
Yes.
We're going to take a quick break. Stay with us. We'll be back with Dr. Marc Gafni. And we're back in the studio with Dr. Marc Gafni. Marc is a leading voice in bringing unique self-enlightenment into the world, an emergent post-modern wisdom lineage, which builds on his national bestseller, Soul Prince, winner of the Nautilus Award for Best Spirituality Book, as well as the highly acclaimed Your Unique Self, which we've been talking about today. And I understand later on, Marc, you will be releasing the Radical Kabbalah, which is based on your doctoral dissertation with Oxford University. Is that right?
That is right.
Yay. When is that coming out?
That is actually, it actually technically is out on Amazon already.
Okay.
But we haven't yet done a release of it.
Okay.
And my mother's very happy. There we go.
So before the break, Marc, we were talking about the description you offered of your unique self, all of our individual unique selves, and we just got to the good part, which is our contribution not only welcomed, but necessary. And I'd love for you to kind of expand on that.
Yeah, totally good, Cynthia, and a delight to be with you.
Oh, it's such a pleasure to have you.
Total good. So let me go back two steps and then forward.
Please.
You know, the premise understanding of the world is we live in a world of outrageous pain. The only response to outrageous pain is outrageous love. That's our premise. That's our, if you will, that's our core credo.
Okay.
Now, to be an outrageous lover means there's something I can do that's outrageous. Now, that outrageous thing, it can't be done by you. That would just make it common.
Right.
Outrageous means it's something that I, as a function of who I am, my life history, my life story, everything that I bring to bear from all the previous generations that all come and crystallize in this unique, irreducibly stunning, gorgeous form called me, right? You, called God having a you experience, right? I can bring that to bear in a way that no one else can.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's my irreducible uniqueness, but it's not the uniqueness of my separate self, meaning it's not the uniqueness of me being separate from everyone, and my uniqueness is what kind of distinguishes me in the way of separating me. My uniqueness is more like a puzzle piece. And a puzzle piece, think about a puzzle piece, it's utterly unique. You don't want to meditate in order to round it out.
No.
Right? You want to actually accentuate its gorgeous uniqueness, because its uniqueness is what allows it to complete something in the puzzle that no one else but you can complete. And then the puzzle, think about the puzzle receives the puzzle piece and holds it.
Uh-huh.
So the puzzle piece is actually held in that connection and contributes irreducibly, uniquely to the wholeness of the puzzle. And if one puzzle piece is missing, our eye goes exactly to that missing puzzle piece and we say, oh my God, right? What's missing? And what's missing is you, right? And that's an enormously empowering realization, but it's not just psychologically empowering, it's actually in alignment with the core nature of reality. And the nature of reality is that who I am is, I am an irreducibly unique puzzle piece who can contribute acts of outrageous love, outrageous creativity, right, to the completion, right, of a world that's missing something. And that which the world is missing, I can bring to the world.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it doesn't have to be a new treaty, right, on, you know, water distribution rights with New Zealand, which is might be important, but that might not be yours to do. It might be to open a soup kitchen. It might not. It might be, for example, to heal the lineage of feminine anger in your family.
Mm.
Wow. Right? It might be to actually be a force for opening of heart, right, in your immediate circle. Mm-hmm. It might be to hold that one person and bring them and invite them forward to their fullness in a way that no one else in your circle but you can do, right? It might be to write something. It might be to, right, but there's something consistently, always, right, that you can do that no one else can do in quite the way you can do because you're situated in a unique place in the space-time continuum that gives you an irreducible, unique perspective on reality, gives you unique insight, which creates irreducibly unique gifts that no one else can give but you. As there's a poem that's yours to write. Mm. There's a life that's yours to live. There's a gift that's yours to give that can't be given by anyone else but you. And that gift is the source of your joy. It's the very meaning and purpose of your life. And it's not one time, right? It's a continual re-engagement and embrace of your unique story with its unique gifts that gives your life a sense of aliveness, meaning, purpose, power, delight, joy, because all those things come together.
You know, as you're speaking about that, it reminds me, Mark, or it brings a question to mind. I wonder if so many people are looking for entertainment, and is that perhaps related to not having that sense of joy or that sense of connection uniquely for themselves?
Well, there's two. That's a great inquiry, Cynthia, right? There's two kinds of entertainment.
Yeah.
There's entertainment which is escape entertainment.
Okay.
Which, you know, every once in a while has some value. Right? Get to relax a little bit. Right? But usually escape entertainment is I feel numbed out by life. Right? I feel like I'm not alive. I feel like I'm not making a creative contribution. I feel like if I wasn't here, someone else would just take my place. So let me just kind of turn off for a couple hours and forget about the pain,
mm-hmm.
which creates a kind of addiction, right?
There's because you can't ever satisfy it.
That's right.
You just have to remedicate.
That's right. So there's a kind of entertainment addiction.
Uh-huh.
I call it the fun addiction. Now, we all want to have fun, but there's fun, which is depth fun. It's really deeply joyous because I'm expressing my unique creativity. I'm giving my unique gift. And there's fun, which is just, let me just have some more fun so I can get away from, right, the sense that, you know, I'm kind of drifting through life and it's all kind of a tale told by an idiot full of sounds and furies signifying nothing, right? And so entertainment, right, really should be something that actually provokes me, that opens me, that invites me, that challenges me, right, that somehow is part of my transformation, as opposed to kind of just simple, straight escape entertainment, which after a certain point is just actually boring.
Right, so you have to keep escalating or medicate in a different dose.
Got to keep upping your addiction, right, because you're trying to fill the emptiness.
Right.
And the only real way to fill the emptiness, right, is to actually get really quiet and let your own fullness emerge. So whenever a person feels like, wow, I want to escape, I want to get out of here, you gotta get out of here, like that song, right? Gotta get out of here, right? So what you gotta do is you gotta just stop and just feel the hole arising in you.
Mm.
Don't try and go anywhere and just sit. Don't do anything. Don't 15 minutes sit and let your own natural fullness emerge, because it always will. And that's the only way through the hole. You can only go through, you can never go around. And we try, Cynthia, to do something that I sometimes call a void dance. Right? A void dance, right? We try and dance around the void.
The void.
And there's no way to dance around the void. You can only dance through it, right? Dancing to the end of love, right? And the only way you can dance through it is through the awakening of your unique self, source of all your power, all of your joy, all of your creativity.
We're speaking with Dr. Marc Gafni, a local author, teacher, and visionary, and this is Simple Life. So when you were explaining to us earlier, Mark, about the possibilities of what our unique gift is to contribute into the world, I wanted to get your perspective on how a person might know they're unique. What are the cues that would lead them to being able to recognize what that is for them?
Great. So in order to know that, you have to do four or five really simple but profound steps, and you do them all the time.
Okay.
First, just get a feeling for yourself.
Get to know yourself.
Right. Well, I would say more than get to know yourself, which is absolutely wonderful and great, but get a feeling for yourself.
Okay.
Right. Get a feeling for your Cynthia-ness.
Uh-huh.
Right. And we actually spend lots of time trying to get out of ourselves, but actually get a feeling for your own unique quality. the unique taste that you bring to the world. And just actually feel into it, because actually, part of awakening is to actually feel the quality of your uniqueness and to actually find it and know it and rejoice in it and delight in it. And then you go another simple step is just a great way in, which is make a little list of five things. And you can just take out a pen and paper right now and write them down. And this is kind of an instant unique self hint, right? And it kind of gives you a direction of where it goes. So on the piece of paper, make five columns. And on the first column, write my unique pleasure. And write what are your one, two, and three. What are your three unique pleasures? One through three in that order. What do you just most enjoy doing? Right? What do you enjoy a little bit less, but your three top unique pleasures, number one. Number two, write, what are the things that I would do today, even if I wasn't paid to do them?
Nice.
Right? One, two, and three. Right? Third column, write, what are those things that I was really good at and enjoyed doing when I was young that I forgot?
Mm-hmm.
Because they didn't fit into culture's image of me, my own self-perception, right? Somehow I lost them, right? Those kind of early talents. And if you're not sure what they are, if you can't quite access them, right? This is in column three.
Okay.
Just ask a bunch of your friends, right? Because your friends often see you more clearly than you see yourself.
That's so true.
So ask a bunch of your friends who knew you when you were young, what were those things that I was good at back then? What do you remember me for? And you'll get three, okay? Then column four, write down, okay, from your own self-perception now, what are your unique talents or your unique gifts that you have to offer? Your three unique talents. That's column four. And then finally, in column five, write down, what are the three unique needs, N-E-E-D-S, the three unique needs in your circle of intimacy and influence,
mm-hmm.
right, that actually are real and substantive. Unique need one, unique need two, unique need three. And if you then look at that, it's going to take you about a half hour. You will actually get a vision, a glimmer, an insight, an intimation of your unique self. Because your unique self is precisely where your unique pleasure and your unique talent, your unique gifts meet the world's need, right? And meets the world's needs, not in the big world sense, your world.
Yeah.
And your world, which is inseparable from the larger world. That's where it gets exciting. Your world, there's no separation between your world and the larger world. And if you actually address the unique need in your world as the unique self, that will then ripple out to the person next to you and the person next to you and the person next to you. We call that, it's an incredibly wildly exciting idea in science in the last 25 years, we call that self-organization. Self-organization, or what Turing, right, the great code cracker in World War II, Robert Turing, right, called morphogenesis. Self-organization means, let me give you a simple example, an anthill.
Okay.
An anthill is unbelievably sophisticated. It does things which involve measurement, calculation, which require enormously complex intelligence. And yet it's clear that every individual ant doesn't have that intelligence.
Right.
How does it happen? It happens because there's a process in nature which is called self-organization. And self-organization, which is an evolutionary process, is when each person in the system or each being in the system acts locally, thinks locally, but all of those local actions and thoughts, as it were, have a global impact. What the ant does is the ant attends to the signals from the ant next to him. And that ant attends to the signals to the ant next to him. And there's a ripple of communication that ripples through the entire anthill that creates, right, from all these local unconscious actions, right, this global sense of an anthill that does things which are massively intelligent. So imagine a unique self symphony in the world, in which every single person is actually not trying to solve the problems of the world. That doesn't work, right? Communism tried to solve the problems of the world, right? Socialism tried to solve the problems of the world, wound up killing about 100 million people in the 20th century, right? Communism, socialism, meaning solve the problems of the world top down.
Got it.
Destroyed more of the world than any other single force in history, all the religions combined. More negative effect. Disaster. But if you actually go bottom up, not top down, bottom up, self-organization, where everyone's playing their unique role in the story. However, unlike an ant who does it instinctually, the human being's invitation is to choose unique self. So my job is not to solve the problems of the world, it's to engage the unique need through my unique gifts and my unique creativity in my system. And in doing that, I, however, not only address those needs, I actually begin to affect this ripple wave-like intelligence, love intelligence, that then begins to spread to the person next to me and the person next to me, and eventually it spreads to the system, and you unleash infinite creativity, infinite innovation. See, our resources are limited. Our creativity isn't.
Mm-hmm.
And our creativity stems from uniqueness.
Mm-hmm.
Right? It's my unique insight, my unique self, that's the matrix of my creativity. And if every person unleashes the creativity of their unique self, you actually create in the world a cacophonous, gorgeous, stunning, unique self symphony that can solve every single challenge, from climate change, right, to terrorism, to currency deflation, right, to poverty, right, to abuse. Every single challenge can be solved, not by kind of a top-down government-imposed solution, but by unleashing the symphonic creativity of every unique self. So unique self becomes not a clever New Age idea, right, not a kind of spiritual strategy. It becomes the very sacred technology at this juncture in history in which we need a new sacred technology, right, in which we're actually beset by challenges unlike qualitatively different than any that we've ever been challenged by. And no government, no think tank is going to work it out. What's going to happen is if we actually engage the basic structure code of unique self, recognize that we have that unique creativity, that unique ability to gift, to give, to live, and we live it to our fullest, that will unleash, right, a kind of positively cataclysmic change in the very nature and fabric of reality, right? Unleashing, you know, what the great books once called a heaven on earth.
Mm-hmm.
But it starts with you. You, right, in your circle of intimacy, in your circle of influence, stepping up to play a larger game, to be an outrageous lover, right? To commit the outrageous acts of love that are yours to commit. And that is the gift, joy, delight, and responsibility
mm-hmm.
of your life.
Well, this is really fascinating, and I totally appreciate how you make this concept and this profound paradigm actually accessible.
Awesome.
It's very accessible, and I want to continue with that. We do need to take another station break.
Let's
so
do that.
Stay with us. We'll be right back with Dr. Marc Gafni on Simple Life. And we're back in the studio. This is Simple Life. We're here with Dr. Marc Gafni. I'm Cynthia Fernandes, your host for this show every week. And before the break, Marc, you were making a very accessible explanation of all of the aspects of finding your unique gift and knowing how to basically uncover it and the necessity of it in the world.
Yeah.
Okay. And that's really exciting to me. It's very fascinating how simple it is when you explain it.
Awesome. Well, you know what it's like, Cynthia?
Hmm.
I mean, we could have in Carmel a Barnes & Noble bookstore, but how boring would that be, right? We are so much happier. I just moved here a year ago, and it's, you know, in our think tank, the Center for World Spirituality is international, but I've just located here kind of personally in the last year. And, you know, when there's a community bookstore like Pilgrim's Way that's been here for 20 years, so it actually, it has a unique self.
It does.
Right, just right. It has a unique contribution. It creates a unique space, a unique cultural interface, a unique repository of wisdom that wouldn't be replaced, right, by a Barnes & Noble fulfilling that same function. Right? And that unique self is, of course, a natural expression, right, of you and Paul.
It is.
Right? It's an expression of your commitment to wisdom, right, to knowledge, right, to creativity, to growth. And that commitment kind of suffuses the store. So the store is not merely delivering books. And it's not just that you have a different selection of books that are actually picked out a little differently than would be by a kind of standard buyer. So therefore it's more interesting, it's more creative selection, but it's actually that the place itself becomes a place of meeting,
hmm.
right? It becomes a kind of center of heart, right? A center of wisdom. And that gives a kind of unique contribution, right, to the fabric of a community. That's how unique self works. That's exciting.
Well, it's really interesting that you would describe that, because Paul and I have talked about the business many times in terms of trying to understand it. We're in the inside, and we want the business to be healthy and be a viable service in the community. And we realize that we're a small space, literally. But more than that, as people, we don't want to be confused with peddling commodities.
Right.
And so the experience people have in the bookstore and in the Secret Garden is, I think you just nailed it. I mean, people are having a unique experience because it is a unique place. It's an experiential place.
And you know what? Let me make an analogy for you, which maybe will be helpful. So we talk about, you know, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, right? The great American goods.
We just had the 4th of July.
4th of July, pledge allegiance to the flag, born in the USA.
Yeah.
We're good, right? So life is an appropriate value. Liberty, obviously an appropriate value. Pursuit of happiness is a crock.
How so?
Never works. You cannot pursue happiness.
Oh, gotcha.
Whenever you pursue happiness, it always runs in the opposite direction. Hard, fast rule.
Got it.
So the only way you can get to happiness is through the passionate pursuit of something other than happiness, and then happiness emerges as a byproduct of that passionate pursuit. So now, what is that other pursuit, that passionate pursuit of something other than happiness, out of which emerges the corollary, the byproduct of happiness? The answer is your unique self. And it's when you pursue your unique story, when you go to live your story with the unique values and the unique vision that comes out of it, which are part of a larger fabric, right? Then as a byproduct of living your unique self, right, and giving your unique gift, you experience joy, you experience happiness. The same thing's true with a store. Right? When a store, like, you know, when a bookstore pursues profit as its goal, it's there to make profit, usually it closes.
Mm-hmm.
But when it pursues excellence as its goal, then profit becomes a healthy and appropriate byproduct, just like happiness.
Right.
So profit is to the unique self of a business what happiness is to the unique self of a human being. But we have to embrace happiness and embrace profit. One of the things that we've lost these days is we've created this notion of not for profit.
Uh-huh.
Right? An organization is good if it's not for profit. That's a very silly and misguided idea, because actually business, classical capitalism, has actually lifted more people out of poverty since the year 1800, empowered more women, raised more people's consciousness by taking them out of survival needs and allowing them to address the higher needs of life than any other single force in history, including anyone and all of the great religions put together.
Mm-hmm.
Because capitalism is a system based on personal creativity, voluntary exchange, that actually allows for, right, the raising of all boats. Now, of course, there are shadows of capitalism. There's crony capitalism, right, which is, you know, a corrupt system like any other system. But basically, at its core, capitalism is the single most effective system we've had in human history. It's a bottom-up system.
That's true.
It's not like communism. Communism is a top-down system. Capitalism is, you know, what Adam Smith called the invisible hand of the market. It's a bottom-up system based on people's unique creativity and the exchange of goods. Now, there's lots of things that can get in the way of that system. Capitalism has problems, regulation, cronyism, lots of problems, but the core system is right, because the core system is based on a person giving their unique gifts, offering their service, and having that service appropriately rewarded. And so we have to be really careful also about kind of embracing profit, right? Because actually profit is a healthy byproduct, right, of a business that's on purpose.
So it's the result or a measurement of a healthy business.
That's right. That's right. Which is why, you know, although, you know, you didn't suggest to me saying any of this, and you're saying, why is he talking about this? But that's why we have to actually really encourage something like a Pilgrim's Way community bookstore, because it does something for a community to have, right, a local bookstore dedicated to the pursuit of knowledge, right, that's actually built on that unique vision. Mm. It actually changes something in the fabric of a community. And to have a kind of standardized bookstore, right, doesn't actually replace that service.
Well, the measurements and the goals are different.
That's right. So here's a big blessing, right, to Pilgrim's Way's unique self.
Yay.
Yes. Yes, yes, yes.
We're in studio with Dr. Marc Gafni, and we're having a fascinating conversation and speaking in reference to his most current book, Your Unique Self, which we do have for sale in the bookstore. The bookstore, if you're not familiar with it, is in downtown Carmel on Dolores between 5th and 6th. If you need to give us a call for directions or hours, our number is 831-624-4955. And Marc, before we get too far, there was a story that I heard online, I wonder if we have time for, if you're willing to share.
Sure. Right. And I think you told me during the break you're referring to the story about my son Eitan. It's a semi-apocryphal mythic story. It's a beautiful story. Eitan and I laugh about it a lot in a kind of sweet way, but it really captures something about unique self. You see, Cynthia, we all know that in America we admit of many things. We admit of, you know, financial impropriety, sexual impropriety, but no one's ever lonely on a Saturday night. Right? No one admits of loneliness.
Right.
Right? Because loneliness somehow is viewed as some indictment of my life.
Uh-huh.
And if I'm lonely, I'm somehow unsuccessful. I haven't made it. But actually, every single human being experiences loneliness.
Absolutely.
Right? Loneliness is the mark of the human condition. And to transcend, to be liberated from loneliness, right, can only happen in one way. And that is the ability to share your unique self with another person. And that, you know, that kind of crystallized for me, right, in this mythic kind of unfolding. It was about, 25, 30 years ago, I was going to give, no, it was less, maybe 19 years ago, I was going to do a series of talks in Scandinavia.
Mm-hmm.
And on my way out, I grabbed my bag of Aramaic books. Right, Aramaic books are kind of one of my favorite pastimes. And, you know, when you get to a hotel room and it's kind of a little depressing, so if you don't have Prozac, which I don't usually do, you know, Aramaic books seem to do it. Right, so I carry my bag of Aramaic books and, you know, Eitan, my son, says, you know, hey, Dad, you know, take this with you. So he gives me like a shoebox, an oversized shoebox. I was living in Israel at the time, and I stuff it into my bag of Aramaic books, and I go on my way. You know, we make it to Scandinavia. We do the Scandinavian tour for like 3 weeks. I get home to our place in Israel. And, you know, it's like midnight when I get home and Eitan's wide-eyed awake.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we love each other, but he's usually happy to see me the next morning. And he looks at me, I look at him, and like my heart dropped. And he's got a little tear kind of running down his cheek. And he realizes that, and I realize that I hadn't looked at his box because it had kind of gotten stuck under the books and it was a busy 3 weeks. And when you're 24, 25, you're convinced that you're completely transforming every iota of reality and every talk you give. And so I hadn't gotten to his box. And I look at him and I said to him in Hebrew, I said, Eitan, efshar o chance, could I have another chance? And he kind of nods imperceptibly. And I run out to the car and I get my big bag of Aramaic books with his shoebox in it. And I open it on the kitchen table. And out of the box, I find an old cross pen. Remember when we used to write with those cross pens?
Yeah.
And a door handle from our first home in Jerusalem, and a picture of his mother from the Palm Beach newspaper, you know, and a rock. And I say, Eitan, what's this stuff? And he says, Abba, Dad, he says, this is my stuff. I gave it to you, right, and you didn't receive it. And of course, we've done much better since then, but I got something then, which is that we all have a box. And in that box is our stuff. Right, it's the song that only we can sing, right? It's the poem only we can write, right? It's the way of laughing, loving, living, being, and becoming that's ours and uniquely ours alone. And if you will, right, it's not my fingerprint, it's my soul print, right? It's my unique self, right? And loneliness is the inability to share your soul print, your unique self, with another person. And that's for one of three reasons. It's either because you don't know how to communicate it, or there's no one there to receive it. But that's usually not the reason. It's usually not one or two. It's usually three, which is you have no idea what your unique self is. Don't have it, can't share it.
Right.
And that's the beginning of transformation, right? Begin to experience your own unique consciousness and realize that reality is trying to experience itself through you. Realize that evolution, the entire evolutionary process, is awakening in you. Realize that you're an irreducible expression of the love intelligence and love beauty that initiated all that is, that you have unique gifts to give and that you're not an extra on the set, that no one else can live your life, no one else can give your gifts. And that's the source, it's the portal to your power, right? It's the source of your strength, right? It's everything. Realizing, beginning to realize that change in your life, aligning not with your egoic small self, but aligning with your unique self, which is evolution, divinity awakening as you. It's the change that changes everything, changes your whole life.
That is fascinating. I'm so grateful for you to share that. It touches me. I mean, I've got to kind of keep the tears back a little because it's so innocent and so authentic,
yeah.
And I really appreciate
that. It's so basic and it's so available to every human
being.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah.
You know, one of the things we do on the show, Marc, is find out what people's favorite book is. Now, this would be your favorite book of all time, and it might
favorite
very
book
be,
of all time.
Yeah, it might be one of those Aramaic books.
Yeah, my favorite book of all time. Well, I'm going to tell you is actually surprise. It's going to be surprising to you.
Okay, good.
My favorite book of all time is the Bible.
I like it.
Yeah, I actually love the Bible. I'm not a fan of biblical fundamentalism.
Okay.
Right? The Bible has been hijacked by fundamentalist communities.
Well, there's thousands of translations.
Right. There's lots of translations. So, for example, when a fundamentalist community says, you know, hey, the world was created in 6 days, I kind of get a little bit, you know, really? I mean, the sun and the moon aren't created till the fourth day. Right? Third and fourth day is, you know, the creations of those things which create sun, you know, moon, and 24-hour days. So clearly it wasn't created in 6 days. It's six periods of evolutionary time. So when I say the Bible, I don't mean biblical fundamentalism. I mean the kind of energetic transmission, right, of the sacred biblical text in its most powerful form, which transmits a sense of, right, actually acting as a prophetic voice in the world, challenging the status quo. Right? We can leave Egypt. We can transform. History is not just a circle. History is going somewhere. Mm-hmm. And we're actually participants in that unfolding. And we're empowered. And every human being is homo imago Dei, meaning an infinite expression, right? A uniquely infinite expression of all that is with gifts to give. And so the biblical legacy is one that we actually, I think, need to reclaim in this country in a post-fundamentalist way. Right, because there's actually a shared language of ethics and a shared language of aliveness and a shared language of eros, right, in the prophets that's enormously important. And we need to weave that together with the best of progressive thought, with the best of evolutionary thought, with the best of Eastern mysticism. But we don't want to lose our grounding in that great biblical vision, right, of the values-driven life.
Right.
That's powerful. We need to reclaim that from kind of conservative fundamentalist communities, bless them, but which have a very kind of homophobic, ethnocentric, right, you know, only Christianity is right view of the world. We need to broaden, right, the view, recognize the unique gorgeousness, the unique self of every great religious system, right, and envision a world in which we're participating, right, as partners with divinity. And that's a great biblical contribution. So I read extensively, you know, science, physics, mathematics. I read Buddhism, Christianity all the time. Right? But kind of I'd say my favorite book would be kind of the Five Books of Moses.
Nice.
I like those books.
And what are you reading now, Mark?
I am now reading a gentleman named Habermas. Right? Habermas is a one of the great kind of integral thinkers who writes about kind of the function and nature of value spheres in the world. I would not recommend it to anyone. Right? Completely impossible reading. But Habermas is a great and awesome thinker.
Wow, that's fantastic.
Yes.
So if you'd like to know more about the Center for World Spirituality, please find it online. And Marc Gafni, you will find there as well. There's plenty of books and daily contributions of wisdom. Really want to thank you for being here, Mark.
Thank you, Cynthia, for having me. What a delight.
Such a pleasure. And join us next week on Simple Life, Stories for the Adventurous at Heart. Until then, we'll see you at Pilgrim's Way.